This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily prayer. Your very word living in me. And I'm desperate for you. And I'm lost without you. This is the air I breathe. This is the air. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me. And I'm desperate for you. Oh. And I'm lost without you. For I'm lost. For I'm lost without you.
Good morning, Koinonia. Welcome to our virtual celebration. We can't hug each other, but at least we can connect in spirit and in soul. I also want to specially mentioned this morning our mothers. It's Mother's Day, and we want to celebrate all our mothers, and specifically those who became a mother in the last year for the first time, or who became a grandmother for the first time in the past year. In this lockdown time, I think you might have felt that you are the world's worst mother and homeschool teacher, but I want to encourage you this morning that you were still God's first choice to raise that son or daughter of yours. So if you have your mother with you, or your mother's not with you, send her a message telling her, "Mom, I am stinking rich with you in my life." If your children can't speak yet, pick them up and tell them, "You are stinking rich with me in your life." Yeah, so hats off to all the mothers, and we want you to remember that you are way worth, more worth than gemstones. So yeah, let's pray. Father, thank you that we can just come before you this morning, and that we can worship and honor you as our God and King. Thank you that the church is not closed. The church is just meeting in different places. Lord, thank you that you are refining us and that you are bringing closer together, even in a time where we can't really see each other that often. Lord, and I want to pray that as we dig into your word this morning, that you will speak to each and every one of us in a unique way, Lord. And I ask that, and I thank you for that, in the name of Jesus. Amen. I have a word for someone. I want to encourage a man. You are wearing a checkered shirt or like, you know, in Afrikaans, a blokkie simp. Or you are normally wearing it, or you're currently wearing it, I'm not sure. And I also see the color turquoise. I don't know if it's your favorite color or is it something, a color that means something to you. But I just saw this, and also that you are a very meticulous person. And people around you will even say that you're a little bit predictable in your personality, very precise, like to do things right. And you like to do sums and work with math. But recently your sums didn't add up, and at first you were a little bit concerned and worried, but I just saw that the last couple of days you really started to doubt your worth as husband and as provider of the home, and you started to doubt your worth as a human being. And I just want to encourage you this morning. God is seeing your heart. He's seeing your efforts, and he just want to reaffirm your worth this morning, and that there is nothing wrong with you or with your worth. And he also want to tell you that he is the faith factor in your deficit. In other words, in your sum. So your deficit plus Jesus equals a positive that is as green as grass. And he's inviting you and encouraging you to put your faith once again in him, and he will be there for you. He will turn your deficit into a positive. There's a second person that I want to give a word to, and that is someone, I'm not sure if it's a man or a woman, but you were lately really disappointed by a dad or a father figure or someone you're looking up to who destroyed your trust. And you are battling with trust, you are battling trusting people around you, and it's even to a point where you are battling to trust God. And God wants to encourage your heart, he wants to heal your heart this morning, and he wants to reaffirm that he is faithful, he is trustworthy, and he is an anchor in this time that you can hold on to in this time. So yeah, I just want to encourage you with that. I came into this lockdown period, and I set specific goals for myself for the first 21 days. And it's already weeks after that initial lockdown time, and still a lot of those on my list is not finished, or I haven't got to it to finish it. And I was just really, you know, a little bit worked up about this whole thing. And yeah, I even for one of the examples, I managed to get done. One of the things that I was so glad that I could get done was, you know, to plan a little bit of homemade delicatessen. And I was planning to do at least three of those or two of those a week. And it ended up maybe once a weekend that I would bake or make something. And one of these ended up to be a three ingredient mealy bread that I flopped. And it turned out to look more like pop that was asking for milk and sugar, you know, to be edible by any means. And this is just one area of my life where I set these goals and started to become quite disappointed, you know, in my accomplishments. And I was a little bit overwhelmed with what was happening around me. And also I struggled a little bit with comparison. And I went to God with this at some point, and I said to God, God, is there something I did wrong? Because there's definitely something I'm doing wrong. Something is not working out. Why is it that I don't see the fruit, you know, of what I was planning for to see in this time? And God spoke to me over a couple of days, and I actually want to tell you, or to, you know, share some of that with you this morning. And I titled it, A Time to Prepare. A Time to Prepare. So the corona lockdown time that we are in is really different for each and every one of us. Someone said lately that we are all in different boats, but we are in the same storm. We are all in different boats, but we are in the same storm. Some are home for weeks now. Some are working harder than ever before. Some are fighting symptoms of the disease and really trusting God for healing someone who has a disease, who is suffering from the coronavirus. And then there are some who doesn't even know anyone who's affected by it. Some are lonely, and some are constantly surrounded with noise and chaos. Some are hoping for income, and some are hoping for rest. Our boats are different, but we are surely in a unique and unpredictable storm, which changed all of us, and it's forcing us, it's challenging us to think and to plan and to act differently for the future. So regardless of the boat that you are in, I really hope that what I share this morning will resonate in your heart, and that it will help you to untangle the thoughts and the emotions that you are wrestling with and facing in this time. When I told Father God that, I went to him and I said, "Father, I don't know, why is it that I don't see the fruit that I'm supposed to see?" God said to me, he said, "Louise, you know what, there's a time for fruit and there's a time for harvest. But the time that you are in now is a time where I want to prepare the soil of your heart for the fruit of the next season." God wants to prepare the soil of our hearts for the fruit of the next season. This is a time where he wants to clean and pull out weeds and till and water and soften the soil of our hearts so that we can be ready for the seed of the new season. There are many ways that we can probably define this and talk about this, but I want to do it by means of three W's this morning. The first one is worship, weeds, and word. Worship, weeds, and word. And I'm going to touch on each of these before we can close today. The first one, when I refer to worship, I'm not necessarily just talking about joining in with songs or singing songs. Of course, it's so part of it. But what I'm referring to here is more to what Exodus 9 verse 1 and John 4 is telling us what worship is. And I want to read this in Exodus 9 verse 1. It says, "Go back to Pharaoh. The Lord commanded Moses, tell him, this is what the Lord, the God of the Hebrews, says, let my people go, so they can worship me." And that worship here is to serve or to be under new management. In other words, you're not the slaves of Pharaoh anymore. You are now under new management and you are serving God. John 4 verse 24 says, "For our God is spirit. To those who worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth." And the worship here is the Greek word proskuneo, which means to bow down before God. It is to kiss his hand out of respect. That is what it means to worship him, to bow down before God and to acknowledge who he is. It is to shut out everything that is influencing us in this moment and to really allow him to show us who he is. He's God of the universe. He is our creator. He defines our purpose. He rooted us in his love and he prepared and provided for everything that we would ever need. This is the God that I want us to focus on, for a moment, and to see, when everything is shut out, who is this God that we are worshiping? He's not only the one who gives meaning to our existence. He's also bigger than any government, any system, or any disease. And I want to ask each and every one of us this morning to allow God to root you in his love this morning. Allow him to define or to redefine your purpose in life. And let me tell you, to be a teacher or a car salesman, that is not our purpose. That is just the vehicles that God is using to fulfill his God-given purpose through our lives. Our purpose starts with a very close relationship with him. This God that we are serving, it starts with a close relationship with him. Jan and Chris was actually referring last week in their sermon to reset, that we are in a time that we need to reset. And when you reset a cell phone or a computer, it doesn't reboot blank. It reboots to the manufacturer's settings. And Adam and Eve is an example, when they were in the Garden of Eden, is an example for us of manufacturer's settings. As where they just walked in the cool of the day with Father God, and they could share and talk to him about everything and anything, and they listened to his everything and his anything. I just really believe that worship is to allow God to give us a fresh perspective of life, the life that we find ourselves in, and to give us a fresh picture of His love for us in this time. Secondly, we allow Him to uproot weeds. So if we say that we come before Him in worship, we get our perspective right. Secondly, is to allow Him to uproot the weeds in preparation for our hearts. Weeds creep in, and that's what I believe mainly when we believe what we believe about God and what we believe about ourselves when it's not in line with God's word. That's how I believe weeds creep in. And it is triggered by things like what we listen on the news and on social media. That's when we start to struggle with weeds. When we believe that we are worth less and that God can't really change or do anything, that's when we struggle with weeds. I put this secondly because I believe that we can only identify and allow God to deal with the weeds in our hearts once we came to the place where we recognize Him who He is, once we come to a place of worship back to Him. And I want to once again encourage each and every one of us to allow Him to uproot the weeds in our hearts this morning, the weeds of fear, to allow Him to uproot bitterness, to allow Him to uproot comparison, jealousy, rebellion, pride. You know that Proverbs 16 verse 5 says that pride is an abomination to the Lord. It is horrific. It is a disgrace to Him. Pride, I believe, is birthed out of fear. Pride goes hand in hand with ungratefulness. It goes hand in hand with being concerned about oneself. Pride can't say sorry. It is disrespectful and it is arrogant. Humility, on the other hand, that catches the eye of God. That's what the word tells us. It seeks the interest of others. It is sympathetic and it is kind-hearted. It shows respect. And God rewards humility with wisdom, with life, and grace and honor. So I want to encourage each and every one of us, allow God to uproot those weeds from our hearts, those things that makes the soil hard and unable to receive water, unable to receive new seed for the new season. Lastly, I want to talk about the word. Let's allow the water of God's word to soften and penetrate the soil of our hearts and to strengthen our root systems, to nourish our root systems. We are surrounded with messages these days, with petitions. We are surrounded with memes, opinions, statements, and we need a plumb line. We need something that will root us in the direction that we need to go. All these other things that we are hearing is playing with our emotions, you know, like a paper boat on a stormy sea. We need a plumb line. We need a standard that will help us and enable our hearts to produce fruit for the next season. Psalm 1 verse 1 to 3, very familiar psalm, but I want to read it this morning from the New Living Translation. Oh, the joys of those who do not follow the advice of the wicked, or stand around with sinners, or join in with mockers, but they delight in the law of the Lord, meditating on it day and night. They are like trees planted along the river bank, bearing fruit each season. Their leaves never wither, and they prosper in all they do. Jeremiah 17 says in verse 7 and 8, but blessed are those who trust in the Lord and have made the Lord their hope and confidence. They are like trees planted along the river bank with roots that reach deep into the water. Such trees are not bothered by the heat. They're not bothered by the coronavirus. They're not bothered by the economy. Or worried by long months of drought. Their leaves stay green, and they never stop producing fruit. If we just allow God's word to water the soil of our hearts and to strengthen our root system, we will bear fruit and never stop bearing fruit. Once we discover the truth in God's word and experience the cool and nourishing water of His word, it will fill us with joy again. You know, joy is not happiness. Happiness depends on happy circumstances, on happy happenings, on good happenings. But joy is an inner conviction regardless of circumstances. And once we discover God's word in it, it brings, you know, joy forth in our hearts and it starts seeping through our veins. Nehemiah promises that it will become our strength. This joy will become our strength in this time. And then in a year or 5 years from now, when we look back on this time, we will remember it as a time of preparation for victory and not for defeat. Let's pray. Father, thank you that we can, in the midst of very uncertain circumstances, we can know one thing for sure, and that is nothing can challenge the truth of your word. Nothing can challenge the amount of love that you have for each and every one of us. Lord, you never promise us that everything will always be easy in this life. But one thing we do know is that you are always in everything God Emmanuel, God with us. Lord, I pray that you will help each and every heart, Lord, to recognize you who you are, to allow you to remove the weeds from our hearts, to soften our hearts with the truth of your word, Lord. Help us to find joy in the midst of everything and strengthen us with that. I pray for everyone who's watching this and their families and their loved ones, Lord, that you will bless us in this time and in the season to come. And maybe we'll look back on this time, enjoying the fruit of investing in this time the way that we should. And I pray that we will look back and remember it as a time of victory. And I thank you for that in the name of Jesus. Amen.
In the dust at the foot of the cross, where mercy paid for me, where the wrath I deserve, it has gone, it has passed, your blood has healed me. Mercy. Mercy as endless as the sea, and I will sing your hallelujah for all eternity. We will lift up the cup and the bread. Break, remembering your love. We were falling from grace, but you took on our shame and nailed it to a cross. Mercy. As endless as the sea, I will sing your hallelujah for eternity. And mercy. May I live I will kneel in the dust at the foot of the cross where mercy paid for me.